like to welcome you all to our service this morning. We're going to begin by singing number 133 in the supplement book. Number 133 in the supplement book.
Oh, we have come to His house together.
Said to him, "Why do you call me good? No one is good except God alone. You know the commandments. Do not commit adultery, do not murder, do not steal, do not bear false witness, honor your father and mother." And he said, "All these things I have kept from my youth." When Jesus heard this, he said to him, "One thing you still lack. Sell all that you possess and distribute it to the poor, and you shall have treasure in heaven. And come follow me." But when he had heard these things, he became very sad, for he was extremely rich. And Jesus looked at him and said, "How hard is it for those who are wealthy to enter the kingdom of God? For it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God." They who heard it said, "Then who can be saved?" But he said, "The things that are impossible with people are possible with God." Peter said, "Behold, we have left our own homes and followed you." And he said to them, "Truly I say to you, there is no one who has left house or wife or brothers or parents or children for the sake of the kingdom of God who will not receive many times as much at this time and in the age to come eternal life." Then he took the 12 aside and said to them, "Behold, we are going up to Jerusalem, and all things which are written through the prophets about the Son of Man will be accomplished. For he will be handed over to the Gentiles, and he will be mocked and mistreated and spit upon. And after that they have scourged him, they will kill him, and the third day he will rise again." But the disciples understood none of these things, and the meaning of this statement was hidden from them, and they did not comprehend the things that were said. Let's pray.
The Lord, our God, our Father in heaven, we are thankful for this morning, this first day of the week. Father, we are reminded every first day of the sacrifice that was given on the cross of Calvary so long ago so that we could be redeemed and that we could be called your children. Father, we always try to live our lives in such a way to bring honor and glory to you, and sometimes we fail, and we pray that you will forgive us from our sins when we do sin. And Father, we pray that we will repent from those sins and do them no more. Father, we thank you for Jesus and the courage that he had to go to the cross, to endure all the things that he endured all the way there, and he did all of that to show his love and your love for us. And Father, we're just so grateful for that. Father, let us join together this morning as we worship you, that we do so with love in our hearts, that we always look to you and keep our minds focused on you and not the cares and the things of this world that so easily ensnare us every day. Father, we pray that you will be with us as we enter into a Bible class time, that we study your word diligently, that we will keep these things in our heart, finding them to be true, and live them out in our daily walks of life. Father, we pray that you will be with each and every one of us as we struggle with various things of this world, that we put those things aside to look to you only, look to you foremost, and in all things that we do, that we try to follow after you. And Father, we just know that there's so much going on around us that we would be better off to put the blinders on and to just keep focused on the things ahead and to live the life that you would have us to live. Father, we pray all this in Christ's name. Amen.
The lesson sheets I just handed out are for the rest of chapter 2 and starting on chapter 3. Is there anybody that does not have the lesson sheet that is 1 and part of 2 where we get started? I don't think I gave you one. Did I lay one down there? Yeah, okay. I think it's 3, but that's all. Okay, so he's got an extra one. He'll give it to you. Okay, sorry I hadn't got more done at one time, but I actually carried it with me every day last week to work, and I was going to work on it in my spare time, and I ended up not doing anything on it, so I'll work on it when I get home. We are in the book of 1 Timothy. We do appreciate everyone being here, appreciate those that join us online as well. We are in studying in the book of 1 Timothy. Paul is writing this letter, and we talked about that last week. This is just simply a letter that the Apostle Paul wrote to a younger preacher named Timothy. He probably was responsible for Timothy's conversion. It seems, if you go back to Acts 15:16, that it was through Paul that Timothy was converted. So he refers to him as his son in the faith, as his true son in the faith, and other terms like that. And so he feels very close to him, and he's sort of a mentor for Timothy. And he uses Timothy in the work, and we see even here in this chapter where he left Timothy, and when he left Macedonia, he left Timothy in Ephesus to work with the church there and to deal with some problems that were there. It's interesting, in the book of Acts, and what you read in Timothy about the church at Ephesus and the problems they had, Paul doesn't really, in his letter to Ephesus, doesn't really deal with problems like he does in some of the other letters. Thessalonians, he deals with some problems there in the church. And for Corinthians, he deals with problems in the church there. Galatians, he deals with some problems in the churches of Galatia. But in the book of Ephesians, he really doesn't deal with any particular problems, it doesn't seem, that are there at Ephesus. And yet, if you remember in Acts 20, he warned the elders that they would have faced problems and that there would be even some from among the elders that would create some of the problems. And then he writes to Timothy, and he talks pretty harshly about some of these teachers at Ephesus that are teaching things that they should not be teaching. So I find that sort of interesting how that plays out. So I would say that maybe Timothy was able to deal with it and take care of some things. That's why we don't read when he wrote to Ephesus in the book of Ephesians. That may be why, it's because Timothy had already taken care of the things that need to be taken care of. I don't really know. We discussed down through verse 11, question number 9, and talked about that part of it, and that really is the first paragraph. In the next paragraph, he says, beginning verse 12, I thank Christ Jesus our Lord, who has strengthened me, because he considered me faithful, putting me into service, even though I was formerly a blasphemer and a persecutor and a violent aggressor, and yet I was shown mercy because I acted ignorantly in unbelief, and the grace of our Lord was more than abundant with the faith and love which are found in Christ Jesus. It is a trustworthy statement, deserving full acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, among whom I am foremost of all. And yet for this reason I found mercy, in order that in me as the foremost, Jesus Christ might demonstrate his perfect patience as an example for those who would believe in him for eternal life. Now to the King, eternal, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. As Paul writes this, there's an interesting statement there in verse 15. He says, it is a trustworthy statement deserving full acceptance. And there are about, if I remember, and I didn't go back and count them, but it seems to me like I remember it being 5 times that Paul uses that phrase. If I'm not mistaken, he does, I think it's 4 times to Timothy and 1 to Titus. I believe that's right. But I know there's a number of times that Paul uses that phrase. What does he mean when he says it's a trustworthy statement deserving full acceptance? I may even have a question about that later, but if I do, we'll talk about it now anyway. What does he mean by that? Okay, you can trust this, you know. Sometimes we'll make statements similar to that. You know, they say, you know, if I ever said anything that you can put your trust in, this is it, you know, or you can take this to the bank, we sometimes used to say. And other things like that, that says this is something that you can know for sure that this is the truth. Now, it's interesting when Paul makes this statement, sometimes, and this is where you have to sort of go back and look at it, sometimes it refers to things that he has just said, and that's his conclusion to those remarks, and then sometimes that's the introduction to his remarks. So he says, you can count on this, let me tell you, and then he tells you. So you have to sort of look at the context. In this case, I think it really is sort of, it deals with what he says before, but the statement he makes follows. But it's because of what he said previously that he makes the statement that follows it. So anyway, I just thought that was interesting, and those particular passages have always stuck out to me as things that obviously are very important. Paul, and certainly all what Paul writes is important, but he himself says, okay, this is something you really need to pay attention to. And so I find that interesting. Okay, Paul said that Jesus, question number 10, Paul said that Jesus considered him blank and put him into blank, considered him faithful and put him into service. Okay. What does this say about Paul's attitude about his responsibilities and his work as an apostle, as a preacher, as a teacher? Okay. He did. He thought he was doing right when he was persecuting the church. But what does it say that God considered him faithful and put him into service? Okay. Okay. It seems to me that when he says he put me into service, Paul considered his position as an apostle, as a teacher, as a preacher, as a responsibility, not a privilege. He had a job to do, and God trusted him to do the job that needed to be done. And I think that this tells us something about his attitude toward his, we would say, his position as an apostle. And while there are times that he says, I have the right as an apostle to tell you what to do, but I'm not going to. I'm going to appeal to you on the basis of love. That tells us that Paul didn't go around, as we put it today, throwing his weight around because he was an apostle. He considered his responsibility as just that, a responsibility, as a serious work to be done. Yeah. Right, yeah. Right. Yeah, he didn't try to deny what he had been or anything. So the very next question says, he said that he was formerly a blank, a blank, and a blank. He was a blasphemer, persecutor, an injurious, New American Standard says a violent aggressor. He was injurious to the cause of Christ. What does it mean to blaspheme? Talk against, okay, and specifically as it's used in the Bible, talk against who? Against God, okay. As Dwight mentioned, Paul says on another occasion that what he did in all good conscience. Now, how can somebody in all good conscience talk bad about God and talk bad against Jesus Christ? Okay. It was his upbringing and his teaching. He believed with all of his heart that Jesus was an imposter and that all these people that were following Jesus were a bunch of heretics. They were Jewish people who had gone astray, and they needed to be dealt with and they needed to be stopped. And under the Jewish system, the best way to stop somebody that was creating problems religiously was to kill them. I mean, that was the way they did things. And so for Paul, he was going out here and he was persecuting these Christians. He voted for them to be put to death. He held the coat of Stephen when he was stoned to death. He went and arrested them, brought them back to be put in prison and so on. And so he was doing everything he could to stop this cause of Christ. And he believed with all of his heart that what he was doing was right, but it was not. He says, now I look back and I see what I was doing is I was blaspheming. I was actually working against God. I was working against Jesus Christ.
Father, does it seem to you that his previous life, Saul,
I think in the sense of feeling his responsibility to reach people, and particularly Jewish people, I think it did, yes. As far as him feeling any continued guilt for it, I don't think he did. I think he recognized God had forgiven him. That's in the past. I don't have to worry about that anymore. But at the same time, because he had done what he did, believing it was right, he certainly understood why these Jewish people were fighting against him and his teaching. And he tried to reach the Jewish people every way he could. And so that's why every time he'd go somewhere, the first thing he'd do, he'd go to the Jews and try to teach them. And then if they rejected him, or better put, when they rejected him, he would then turn and go to the Gentiles. But yeah, I think that he felt that burden because of that. He was a persecutor. He was a violent aggressor or injurious. That is, he did all he could to stop them physically, not just argue with them and stop them mentally, but he did everything he could physically to stop them as well. He said he acted blank and in blank. Okay. He acted ignorantly, that is, he didn't understand what he was doing. He acted in unbelief. Did Saul believe in God? Yeah, did he? Okay, he didn't believe in Jesus, yeah. And he didn't, you know, he believed in the Bible. The Bible they had at that time, which was the Old Testament, he certainly believed in that and believed it was the law of God, and he believed that people should follow it and so on. So, yeah, I think that the unbelief here has to do with his belief in Jesus Christ, his belief in what really was right. And he thought that he was, you know, doing it right, but he wasn't, and he realized he wasn't. Yeah, blasphemy was directly against Jesus, yes. Did this, since he acted ignorantly in unbelief, did this make his actions right? No, it doesn't. And the same thing's true for us today, and this, I think, is a warning for us, and I think that's one of the reasons he includes it, is this is a warning for us today, because it is possible for us to believe something to be true and it not be true. It's possible for us to believe something is false and it to be true. And, you know, it really is true, and we're mistaken. We don't understand something right. So, yeah, God knows, and I think, in fact, I put a note here. God knew his heart, and he also knew his potential. He knew that Saul of Tarsus was one of these people that didn't do anything half-heartedly. He's one of these guys that did, when he went at it all the way. And not only that, he also knew that Saul of Tarsus probably knew the scripture as well as anybody living in his day. I doubt there was anybody that was very much ahead of him when it came to a knowledge of the scripture. And so with the person armed with the scripture and a zeal to do whatever I can for the cause of God, that person to become a Christian is like a stick of dynamite in the early movement of the church. And so I think that God saw that potential in him and saw his heart was really set on doing what was right. And I think this is another point too, is that when a person's heart is right and they come face to face with truth, they're going to accept it. It may not be an immediate thing like a light bulb comes on, yep, you're right, I'm wrong. It may not be that. If we've been taught something all of our life, it may take us a while to reason through it and accept that what we've always believed is wrong. That's not something that's easy for any of us to admit. You know, I've been taught something wrong all my life, and, you know, it's not right. I got to rethink this whole thing. And so it takes a while. And not only do you have the intellectual part of it that you have to deal with, but you have the emotional part of it as well. Because it is a big emotional trauma for something that's a major part of your life come face to face with I'm wrong and I've got to change. That's not an easy thing to do. So I think that we need to, as far as when we're dealing with other people and trying to teach them, we need to be patient. We need to show them what's true, try to teach them the truth, help them understand the truth, but at the same time be very patient with them, because just because they don't, you know, read it and say, yep, you're right, I'm wrong, doesn't mean that it's not going to change their heart eventually. We have to plant the seed and let it grow. Yeah. And again, that's because he understood the scripture. And once his eyes were open, and once God had appointed him, see, in his case, when he became a Christian, he was appointed as an apostle because God made him an apostle. So that happened immediately, and so I think we have to conclude from that God began to give him revelation of understanding how the scripture should be interpreted. And so given that, he was armed with a knowledge of the scripture, and now he had the Spirit working in him to help him understand the scripture to be able to teach it accurately. And so, yeah, he immediately went. As Dwight said, he didn't wait a year or 2 years or something. He immediately went and began preaching. Shows you how powerful the Holy Spirit is. Also shows you the zeal that Saul had for God and wanted to do what was right. Okay, question number 14. He was shown blank and blank from the Lord Jesus. Okay, mercy and long suffering. Okay. I've got mercy and grace from verse 14. Grace, 13, mercy, 14, grace. That was not one of those that was just a fill in the blank. Even though it is fill in the blank, it wasn't a word for word from Scripture fill in the blank. He said the grace shown to him was what? Okay. It was more than abundant. With the faith and love found in Christ Jesus. And so he says, in spite of what I had done, the grace of God was more than enough to cover. Here I had been responsible for being a blasphemer. I'd been a violent aggressor against the Christians. I had done all of these terrible things. Yes, I acted ignorantly in unbelief, but the grace of God was more than abundant. I mean, if he had just said the grace of God was abundant enough to do it, that would have been, that would have said that God more than covered it. But he said, he didn't just say it's abundant. He said it's more than abundant. Paul, exceedingly abundant, okay, in some translations. And it's interesting how Paul uses adjectives a lot of times. In fact, in the book of Ephesians, he says it's exceedingly abundantly beyond. So, he piles these adjectives on sometimes. And so he says that it's exceedingly abundantly, more than abundant here. All right. Verses 15 and 16, it says, it's a trustworthy statement deserving full acceptance. Christ came to the world to save sinners, among whom I'm foremost of all. And yet for this reason I found mercy in order in me as the foremost, Jesus Christ might demonstrate his perfect patience as an example for those who would believe in him for eternal life. Now this is that trustworthy statement that deserves full acceptance. We already talked about that part of it. But what is it that is a trustworthy statement? What is he saying here is a trustworthy statement? Okay, Jesus came to save sinners. That's sort of the basis of the whole life of Jesus. Jesus said, I came to seek and save that which was lost. He came as the Savior of the world, even heralded by the angels to the shepherds that he came for the purpose of saving people from sin. So that's part of it. All right, what else? Okay, that was the reason he found mercy, is because Jesus came to save sinners. Yeah, that was, and so he was able to find mercy. Now, what else is he saying here? He says that Jesus came to save sinners, and he found mercy, and he received abundant grace, and or more the exceedingly abundant grace. Now, how does that apply to anybody else? Okay, I think if I understand what Paul is saying here, and I think this is what his point is. His point is that look at me, how terrible I was. Look at all the bad things I did. Look who I was. I was a blasphemer. I was a violent aggressor against the church. I was injurious to them. I did all these terrible things, and yet God's grace was sufficient, more than abundant, exceedingly abundant, so much so that I was forgiven of all of my sins. Now, if Saul of Tarsus can be forgiven of that, what does that mean for everybody else? Anybody can be saved. And I think that's the point that he's making here. I think what he's saying is, if I can be saved, anybody can be saved.
Verse 16 basically says that. It says it's a pattern.
Yeah.
For those who believe.
Right. He says, for this reason I found mercy. It's a pattern. This is the example of why. And so he's saying that since, you know, I was the foremost of sinners, and God's perfect patience was demonstrated in me, then God will save anybody that will turn to Him. I find it interesting, if you go over, and we won't take the time to go over and read it, but in 2 Kings 21 and 2 Chronicles 33, King Manasseh, he was the son of Josiah. Josiah or Hezekiah? Manasseh was the son of Hezekiah. Josiah was the son of Manasseh, I believe. He was the son of Hezekiah, I believe. Anyway, Manasseh was known for being what kind of king? He's king of Judah. He was wicked. How wicked was he? He was the standard of wickedness after his life. Just like after the David lived, every time you read about a king being good or bad, it'll very, very often it will refer back and say he did not follow in the steps of his father David. Or he did this, but not as much as David did this. David was the standard for doing it right. Manasseh was the standard for being wicked. And it would say after the life of Manasseh, it would say this king was wicked, but not as bad as Manasseh. Manasseh was considered the worst. He offered up his children as sacrifices. He put idols inside, he put idols and altars, two idols, inside the temple of God. He built every kind of false god you could come up with just about in his day, and had the people worshiping all of these things. And so Manasseh was sort of the standard of wickedness, of how bad somebody could really be. God sent a king in, king of Assyria, and King Sennacherib took Manasseh captive. But while he was in captivity in Assyria, Manasseh repented and recognized what he had done is wrong and asked God to forgive him. God allowed him to return to Judah and become king again. From that point on, the rest of his life, he began to cleanse Judah and the temple and everything else that he had done bad and tried to turn the people back to God. He totally failed in turning the people back to God, but he tried. He really did try. And yet, when you read about him in the book of Kings, it does not even mention his repentance or anything about him turning back. All it talks about is his wickedness. If you go over to 2 Chronicles, it tells you about his coming back and about God being merciful and forgiving him and doing that. I think there is a big difference, and God was willing to forgive Manasseh in spite of how wicked he was. But there's a big difference in Manasseh and Saul of Tarsus. Saul of Tarsus said, I acted in all good conscience to this day. King Manasseh lived under one of the best, most godly kings growing up that Judah had. And yet, in spite of that, he knew what was right, but in spite of it, he totally rejected it and went off and did what was wrong. But either way, whether it was intentional and knowingly doing wrong, or if it was done ignorantly, when they turned to God, God was willing to accept them and forgive them. Right. Yep, you're absolutely right. And he did. Yeah. Yeah. Right. It is. It really is. And the whole point of both of those is just that if we're willing to turn to God, God is willing to accept us and forgive us. It doesn't matter what we have done. And I say that because if you try to talk to people about the Lord, you will, if you talk to very many people, you will run into somebody that's going to tell you that you don't understand how bad I am or all the things I've done in my life, and there's no way that God can forgive me. And remember this in 1 Timothy, and remember the story of Manasseh in 2 Chronicles 33. And if you'll remember those two, you'll have a scriptural basis to tell that person if God can forgive Manasseh and God can forgive Saul of Tarsus, he can forgive anybody. Because you hadn't done anything any worse than what they've done. I mean, this Manasseh just, you go back and you read how all the things he did, and you couldn't get much worse than what he did. Yeah. Yeah, you're right. If God can forgive the ones that nailed Jesus to the cross, he could forgive. Yeah. Yeah, David did some bad things, yeah. But his heart was always right and wanted to do what was right. And that's, of course, is the difference. He was a man after God's own heart. And you see that when he came face to face with his sin, he immediately repented and turned back to God and did what was right. You can be a good person and make some terribly bad decisions and do some bad things. You're absolutely right. And Peter's a good example of that. Just take your pick which time. Peter did a lot of things that he shouldn't have, and yet he wanted to do what was right. He was trying. Yeah. David in the Psalms says, my sin, I think it's Psalms 32 if I remember right, but it says, my sin is ever before me. And I think that's the same way with that we've talked about Saul of Tarsus. I think there is a sense in which I think he never forgot what he had done. There is a sense in which I think he fully accepted God's forgiveness and didn't live with guilt. He just recognized what he had done. And wanted to use that even to help others to come to Christ. What attributes are given to God in verse 17? Okay. And says, to him be honor and glory. That's, I don't know how you can offer up praise any more than that. And this again is one of those where Paul has a knack for just piling it up, you know, not just saying something simply one time, but piling it up. And so he refers to God as the King, eternal. He's immortal. He's invisible. He's the only God. And to him be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. And that's the next question. All right. Question 19. Timothy was told to fight the what? All right, to fight the good fight. So is Is he advocating that we be fighting people? Okay, yeah, fighting the good fight for a good cause, standing for the truth. I think he's talking here about a spiritual battle. You know, if you go to Ephesians 6, it's one place, and then Corinthians he also does too. Talks about the spiritual warfare and talks about the spiritual armor that we use and so on. And so it is a spiritual battle. It's not a physical battle. You know, Jesus told Peter when he pulled his sword, he said, put up your sword. Those that live by the sword will die by the sword. And, you know, in Matthew 5, he said, if a man slaps you on the right cheek, turn the other cheek. So, you know, Jesus did not advocate physical altercations for any cause. But at the same time, there is a spiritual battle, and all of us are in it if we're Christians. We must fight for the Lord. The good news is that if we can just stay on God's side, that ultimately that battle has already been won. It may not have been won in my life for me because I'm still fighting it every day. But if I can stay on God's side and God is on my side, then I have the ultimate victory in Jesus Christ. And Paul says that through Jesus Christ we are more than conquerors. All right. It says he was to keep, and I put thee in there, and the word thee is not in the text. It says he was to keep blank and a good blank, which some had blank. He's to keep faith and a good conscience, which some had, rejected or turned away from. The reason that I mentioned the fact that I put thee in there and it shouldn't be in there is because the faith would refer to the body or system of teaching, where faith refers to the conviction and the belief and the trust. And I think here he's using it in that sense, the conviction and the trust. He was to keep the true conviction and trust in God and a clear conscience, that is, do what he knew to be right. And he said some had rejected that. And he mentions two of them, Hymenaeus and Alexander, and what had they done? Okay, they had blasphemed, and it says they had suffered shipwreck to the faith, in regard to the faith, or their faith, not the faith, their faith. They had suffered shipwreck in regard to their faith. In other words, they had lost their faith, their trust in God, is what it's saying. All right, I'm going to tell you what, our time is almost up, and I'm going to stop there because I want us to talk about question number 22 more length than we have time to talk about it. You might write down 1 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 5 in regard to question number 22. It is related, and we'll talk about it next week, Lord willing, too.
Today's on the announcements. Tracy Kirby woke up not feeling too good, feeling sick. So if y'all can, just be praying for her. I know she'd appreciate it. We got some good news. Trace Birdwell's home from Paris Island. We also have an announcement for the Church of Pettisville invites you to join. Join them for the gospel meeting April 10th through 13th. Barry Kircheville is the guest speaker. I'll put it up on the board after church. Y'all can see what the topics are going to be. Is there anything else? Any more announcements anybody think of? And then Dwight McNatt needs to speak.
As I was coming in the building this morning, Brother Bob Brooks gave me a check. And he said, this check is in memory of Joyce, his dear wife and our wonderful sister. And this check is for $5,000 in memory of our sister Joyce. And we just pray that this money can be used to the glorifying of our great and wonderful Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And Brother Bob, as we was talking in the class this morning, Sister Joyce fought the good fight. And she won that fight. And she is receiving that crown of life for that good fight that she fought. And we praise God for that. And we, like we said, we hope that God always gets the honor and the praise for whatever we do. We do it for His glory, not for our glory. Thank you very much, Bob. And Bob also reminds me that there are dishes in the office from food that was brought to their house during Joyce's sickness. So all of you ladies, look in the office. And if any of these dishes are yours, please take them home with you. Thank you.
This morning, to prepare our minds for the partaking of the Lord's Supper, we'll sing number 950. Sing all three verses of this song. And after this song, Brother Matt will have his remarks.
Oh, your only Son. Thank you.
the Lamb of God. In Exodus chapter 12, beginning of verse 1, it says, "The Lord said to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, 'This month shall be for you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year for you. Tell all the congregation of Israel that on the 10th day of this month, every man shall take a lamb according to their father's houses, a lamb for a household. And if a household is too small for a lamb, then he and his nearest neighbor shall take according to the number of the persons, according to what each can eat, and you shall make your count for the lamb. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a male a year old, and you may take it from the sheep or from the goats. You shall keep it until the 14th day of this month. And when the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill their lambs at twilight, then they shall take some of the blood and put it on the two doorposts and the lintel of the houses in which they eat it. For I will pass through the land of Egypt that night. And I will strike all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both man and beast, and on all the gods of Egypt I will execute judgments. I am the Lord. The blood shall be a sign for you on the houses where you are, and when I see the blood, I will pass over you, and no plague shall befall you to destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt.'" You see, on the 10th day of the month, they were to take this lamb. And then on the 14th, that all of these lambs would be killed at the same time. If you think about the amount of blood that was going to flow for every household to have killed a lamb on that evening when they were all gathered together, then they were to take that blood and they were going to put it over the entryway into each of their houses, and they were going to put that blood up over there as a sign to the Spirit of the Lord to pass over that this house, that they have put their faith into God Almighty, and that this lamb has taken the place of the firstborn of this household. Here we can see clearly that this lamb has taken the place of the firstborn, that they have put their faith and their trust into this lamb as they have done exactly what God has said in following God's way. You see, many years later, after this would be carried on year after year, generation after generation, remembering this moment, this huge moment of the deliverance from captivity in the land of Egypt for the children of Israel. Every year they would remember this, and they would tell their children about why we're doing this and about how their fathers did this long ago and how it saved them and how the Spirit of God passed over them and killed not them. Every year they're taking this lamb and they're pulling it on the 10th of this month, and they're setting it aside until the 14th, and they're killing it at night. And this is going on year after year after year. And then there's this crazy guy out in the wilderness. And he has been preaching and teaching and talking about how there's going to be this guy come, and how he's just the forerunner, and how he's just talking about, the Messiah that's going to come, and I'm not even worthy to loosen the strap off of his sandal. And what does he call Jesus of Nazareth when he sees him? You remember? John chapter 1 and verse 29, it says, "Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." This is where we get our lamb. Jesus of Nazareth was the Lamb of God. The Lord has provided to each and every one of us not a lamb for us to gather on the 10th of the month and set aside until the 14th, and then at night. He has given us the lamb. The blood has been spewed out by God Himself. A plague of death due to sin is what He has borne for us. You see, we are subject to death because of our sin. And this lamb was slain on our behalf so that we would not have to suffer the plague of death. Every year, the children of Israel would remember their deliverance from the bondage of slavery. They did this in an annual feast with a reminder. And so much more so should we be reminded weekly of the deliverance of death and sin that we are given by our Lamb, the Lamb of God, from Jesus of Nazareth. You see, He has taken my place. Just like that lamb took the place of the plague so long ago. And we have faith that Christ's blood has covered our plague. This morning when we partake this Lord's Supper, let us celebrate our deliverance with this reminder of unleavened bread and the fruit of the vine.
Dear Heavenly Father, we are thankful to Thee for the love that You showed in us in sending Your Son to this earth to die on the cross for our sins. And Father, we ask Thee now at this time that You bless this bread that represents His body, that we would partake of it in a worthy manner in Your sight. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Jesus, we realize that just as the Lamb was given for those children of Israel to help save them, we realize that Jesus died once for all of us. He became our Lamb, and He was Your Lamb. He was the Lamb of God. And Father, we pray that You would help each of us as we take this fruit of the vine this morning, that we will realize that it represents the blood that was shed as He died as the Lamb for us. Please help us to examine ourselves and take care of it and be pleasing to You. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Song will be number 894. 894.
Oh, to be like Jesus, to be like Jesus, all I ask, to be like Him, all through life's journey.
So yeah. I have seen you walk down a dusty road. I have watched you stumble from my heavy load. In my heart I struggle, but I always hear the Holy Redeemer from heaven was you.
Thankful, Father, for this opportunity that you've given us to assemble here this morning, sing these songs to thee, to come to thee in prayer, to study another lesson from thy word. We pray, Father, that you will be with each one of us that is present this morning, that we came for no other reason but to learn how to better serve thee. Father, we pray that you will be with our sick, those that we may not know about, those that have been mentioned, and we pray that you will heal them, return them back to their much-wanted health, if it be thy will. Father, we pray for those that are bowed down in sorrow over the loss of loved ones. We pray that you will heal their broken hearts as only thou can. We especially pray for Bob this morning as he continues to mourn the loss of Joyce. And heal his broken heart, if it be thy will, Father, and help us to help Bob any way that we can and others. Father, we're thankful for our elders that we have here at Ephesus. We pray that you will be with them. Continue to give them the wisdom they need as they make the decision concerning the church here. We pray that through their efforts and decisions that they make, that the church will continue to grow and the word will be spread both here and in other parts of the world. Be with our deacons, Father, as they carry out their duties each week. Father, we pray that you will be with the men and women that are serving our country at this time. We pray that you will watch over them, protect them, and return them home safely, if it be thy will. Father, we're thankful for Robert and Matt as they work here with us each week. We pray that you will give them a long and happy life in thy service. Father, we pray that you will be with Matt this morning as he brings us the lesson. May he remember well the things that he has prepared. Present them in a way that be well-pleasing unto thee. We pray, Father, that you will be with us now as we continue through this hour of worship and through future lives such as we might have. Pray that you will forgive us of our sins and help us to be more like Jesus each day. These things we ask in Christ's name. Amen.
Psalm before our lesson this morning will be number 425. Number 425.
Do mi sol. Master, the tempest is raging, the billows are tossing high. The sky is o'ershadowed with blackness, no shelter or help is nigh. Carest thou not that we perish? How canst thou lie asleep? When each moment so madly is threatening a grave in the angry deep. The winds and the waves shall obey thy will. Peace be still. Whether the wrath of the storm-tossed sea, or demons or men or whatever it be, no water can swallow the ship where lies the master of ocean and earth and skies. They all shall sweetly obey thy will. Peace be still, peace be still. They all shall sweetly obey thy will. Peace, peace, be still. Master, with anguish of spirit, I bow in my grief today. The depths of my sad heart are troubled. Awaken and save, I pray. Torrents of sin and of anguish sweep o'er my sinking soul. And I perish, dear Master, oh, hasten and take control. The winds and the waves shall obey thy will. Peace, be still. Whether the wrath of the storm-tossed sea, or demons, or men, or whatever it be, no water can swallow the ship where lies the master of ocean and earth and skies. They all shall sweetly obey thy will. Peace be still, peace be still. They all shall sweetly obey thy will. Peace, peace, be still. Master, the terror is over. Elements sweetly rest. Her sun in the calm lake is mirrored, and heaven's within my breast. Linger, O blessed Redeemer, leave me alone no more. And with joy I shall make the blessed harbor and rest on the blissful shore. The winds and the waves shall obey thy will. Peace be still. Whether the wrath of the storm-tossed sea, or demons, or men, or whatever it be, no water can swallow the ship where lies the master of ocean and earth and skies. They all shall sweetly obey thy will. Peace. still, peace be still. They all shall sweetly obey thy will. Peace, peace, be still.
Song of invitation after the lesson this morning will be number 701.
On that day, when evening had come, he said to them, "Let us go across to the other side." And leaving the crowd, they took him with them in the boat, just as he was, and other boats were with him. And a great windstorm arose. And the waves were breaking into the boat, and the boat was already filling, but he was in the stern, asleep on the cushion. And they woke him and said to him, "Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?" And he awoke and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, "Peace, be still." And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. He said to them, "Why are you so afraid? Have you still no faith?" And they were filled with great fear and said to one another, "Who then is this that even the wind and the sea obey him?" In Matthew chapter 8, verses 23 through 27, and Mark chapter 4, verses 35 through 41, Luke chapter 8, verses 22 through 25, we have a story of when Jesus calms a storm. Now, I know for so many of you, this is a story that you have heard before. This account of a miracle that has happened is something that many of you have probably even, I would say, dare to say, have heard 100 times in your life. Does that make the miracle any less true? Well, definitely not. Does that mean that there's something that I can't learn from this? No, definitely, definitely not. This morning, I hope that as we examine the story, that it maybe you learn nothing new. Maybe it's just a refresher and a reminder for you and an encouragement to you about how Jesus can calm a storm. And I hope with everything in me that I can get through this without hacking and coughing and the right side of my nose falling off. But we'll see how that goes. I was doing real good and then the rain quit. You know, rain settled all that yellow cloud that was floating around outside. So I started back on my allergy medicine and then my nose started getting rubbed raw. So I quit taking that because it make my nose run. Now I'm getting stopped back up, but my nose is feeling better. It's just, which one do you want, right? You know, as Jesus did all of these things, and these events occurred, and the disciples that were with him in the boat, and the disciples that were also and followers of Jesus that were in other boats around him as they went across the sea, these people had heard Scripture. They most definitely had studied the Torah. They knew the law of Moses. They knew about the creation of the earth and how God had created the earth. They knew about how their forefathers were delivered up out of the land of Egypt and brought out of captivity, as we looked at this morning, and all of the things concerning the Passover and Sabbath day and what all of that means for them. Many of them had studied the Psalms and the writings of David and Saul and Solomon. They knew about the writings of Zechariah and Isaiah and Jeremiah, and they knew about all of the things that had happened to their ancestors before. But in a moment of terror, do you remember anything that you have ever heard in your life? No. I don't. Unless it has become muscle memory, and it is a knee-jerk reaction, I don't remember anything stored way on back there. How could I? I'm in the middle of dying. How am I going to remember what happened in Psalm 107? How am I supposed to remember that? Psalm 107 and verse 23 says this: some went down to the sea in ships, doing business on the great waters. And they saw the deeds of the Lord and His wondrous works in the deep. For He commanded and raised the stormy wind, which lifted up the waves of the sea. Had He done this before? Well, think about Jonah. Think about what happened with Jonah. He kind of ran away from God. And what did God cause to happen? A storm. He brought up a storm. And if you're here with the disciples, and you're in a boat, and you're going across the Sea of Galilee, you've had all of these opportunities to learn about God and storms. But don't none of that matter when you're about to die? You don't remember none of that. Because if they remembered, they would have remembered what kept on going on and saying. In verse 26, it says, they mounted up to heaven. They went down to the depths. Their courage melted away in their evil plight. They reeled and staggered like drunken men and were on their wits' end. And then they cried to the Lord in their trouble, and He delivered them from their distress. He made the storm be still, and the waves of the sea were hushed. And then they were glad that the waters were quiet, and He brought them to their desired haven. Let them thank the Lord for His steadfast love, for His wondrous works of the children of man. Let them extol Him in the congregation of people and praise Him in the assembly of their elders. If they had only knew, and those that knew, if they had only remembered these words, the events that were occurring to them on the Sea of Galilee wouldn't have mattered squat. It wouldn't have mattered at all. Why? Because they knew what God could do. We went to the beach a few weeks ago, and the whole time we were there, they had something up on a flagpole. There was two of them. They were both red. Do y'all know what that means? Can't go in the water. It don't matter if you was raised on the banks of the Tennessee River. It don't matter if you've been across the Elk or not. It don't matter how many times you've been in Sugar Creek or been down Tiny Piney. It didn't matter about that. Double red flag means don't get in the water. And as I watched and we felt the wind and that riptide that was coming in and going out and the waves that were coming up real high and coming down low, and I've never surfed, but that looked like some good surfing waves. And evidently it was some good waves to not get in either because they had that double red flag up. And the wind was so severe, it was so rough, that when you would walk down the hallway of the place where we were, you walk down the hallway of that hotel, if somebody had the balcony door, that sliding glass door, they had that balcony door open, you could feel the wind coming underneath the door of their room even though it was closed. When you walked by that door, the wind, it was filling the room up so much with wind that it was blowing underneath that door, and you could feel it hit your feet. You could feel it blowing your pants leg. I don't know how anybody was in that room reading the newspaper with the wind blowing that bad, but I think about those kind of waves, and I think about that kind of event. And as the morning happened while we were there, just like it did up here, the tornado sirens began to go off, and our phones started blaring, and it said, tornado warning in your area. And Haley woke me up. She said, Matt, what do we do? I said, well, they build these buildings for Cat 5 hurricanes. I'm going to just ride it out. Well, I mean, what do you want to do? I mean, ain't nowhere for us to go. I mean, just, I'm going to go back to sleep. If it can handle that hurricane, surely, goodness, it'll handle this tornado that we got. And I got class here in about an hour and a half. I'll go back to sleep. So many times we see events like that. We've seen that ocean act like that. And now you imagine being out there in a canoe. Maybe a little bit bigger than a canoe. Imagine being out there in a bass boat, you know, with no motor, and five other people, and paddles. And no wonder they're getting tossed around like men that are drunk and they're on their wits' end. They're getting thrown around. They're not on the Carnival cruise ship. They're about to die. And although we remember and we know that God is in absolute control of any and every situation, when you're in the middle of the situation and you're in the middle of the storm and you're in the middle of the water and you're the one getting tossed around, you can't remember any of that. Unless it becomes who you are. And when it becomes who you are, and it's the very essence of your being, and it's your rising up and it's your lying down, you can always remember that God is in control because you have allowed yourself to be under God's control. You have quit fighting Him. Jesus is the master of the storms of the sea. It is not Poseidon. It is not Neptune. It is not Ariel and King Triton. As much as you would want to believe all of these things, Jesus is the master of the seas and of the storm. And He is also the master of Ebola and COVID and ISIS and the stock market, personal health issues, job loss, and maybe even it is literal storms that scare you and frighten you, many other things. I hope that we leave here with some ammo into helping us become understandingly more confident in the midst of storms, because we have learned that Jesus is the ruler of our lives and we live that way every day. And not just when it's going to be stormy outside and not just when we're underneath a storm watch, but every day. First thing that we always need to remember is this right here, and we learn from this story, is that the disciples follow Jesus. Jesus, when He met these men, yes, He had some interaction with them, maybe about the thing that was presently at hand, but what did He ask every one of them? He said, here's what you need to follow Me. But think about the reading this morning, Mason led us in, follow Me. The disciples followed Jesus. In Matthew chapter 8 and verse 23, as we mentioned, this is found in Matthew, Mark, Luke. We find this in Matthew chapter 8 and verse 23. It says, and when He got into the boat, His disciples did what? His disciples followed Him. So Jesus gets into the boat. And His disciples said, wait, He's getting in the boat? I'm going to get in the boat too. I'll go where He goes. They were carried away with following Jesus. That's what mattered to them, following Jesus. It didn't matter what their mom and daddy said. It didn't matter what their family said. It didn't matter what their wife said or what their husband said, what their kids were doing, what the sky looked like, what was on the news or what the multitudes were doing. They went where He went, and that was the end of it. They were set on following Jesus. And we've got so much stuff because we have made our lives so busy that we have so many things that get in the way of us following Jesus. And then we get in the middle of a storm, and we wonder, where in the world is Jesus at? We have got to follow Him. Following Jesus faithfully will allow us to stop worrying. We oftentimes get caught up in the fact that, what if there's a storm? What if this? What if? What? Instead of just following the Messiah. And we try to make all of these plans and all of these other scenarios about what will happen, and maybe we need to have a plan B and a plan C and a plan D. If plan A is following Jesus, don't worry about the rest of the alphabet. The rest of the alphabet won't matter because plan A works every time. Now, if plan A is I need to figure this out on my own and I need to try to do what's good for me and what's good for my family, and plan B is trying to prepare for the later days of life, and plan C is following Jesus, then you better have a plan A, and a plan B is going to fail. So you're going to try to find another plan C, and plan C ain't going to work because you moved following Jesus on down the alphabet. Plan A, follow Jesus like the disciples follow Jesus. And know that this, even followers of Jesus have problems. I'm going to follow Jesus and everything's going to be fine. Everything's going to be all right because I follow Jesus. The disciples followed Jesus. They got in a boat and what happened? A storm. A storm happened. Jesus said, it's not a bed of roses. Matthew chapter 7, verse 13 and 14 says this, "Enter by the narrow gate, for the gate is wide, and the way is easy that leads to destruction, and those who enter by it are many. For the gate is narrow, and the way is hard that leads to life, and those who find it are few." Who's walking down this? Who's walking through this narrow gate in this difficult way? Well, that's Jesus. Who's going to be following him? The followers of Jesus. And if that's going to be us and we're following after Jesus, he's telling us that this isn't necessarily going to be easy. There's going to be problems. There's going to be difficulties. He says this. He says it's going to be hard and it's going to be narrow and it's going to be difficult. He implores us to come to him anyways for rest. All of these things are happening. Will bad things happen? Absolutely. Difficult things come, no doubt. But coming to Jesus when we are tired and weary and warmed and worn out, even all of these things that happen, he is there to give us rest. Matthew chapter 11, verse 28, "Come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." Overwhelmed with the events of our moment and in our storm, he still says, "Come to me for rest. Come to me and I will take you on. Take my yoke upon you and I will give you rest." Third thing that we need to do is this right here. Don't panic if Jesus is silent. No, I can't quite understand, you know, but I get to read the whole story. I get to read, you know, this is what, about 23, 24, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I get to read about 6 verses and I'm done with this miracle. And that's it. And I'm sitting there going, "Well, Jesus wasn't even worried about it. I don't know why y'all was all worried." But when I'm in verse 2 of my life and a great tempest arises and I'm in a boat and I'm being tossed about, I don't even think about where Jesus is and whether he's asleep and whether he's talking about it or not. All I know is that my life is in peril. And I got to figure out a solution to it. And we need to be mindful of the fact that if we are following after Jesus, and we know that if we follow Jesus, we're going to have problems, that if Jesus is not worried about it and he's not uptight about it, then neither should we. Well, since he's not worried, maybe I need to be worried for him and me both. And that maybe I'll be worried enough for both of us. And that'll take care of it. Matthew chapter 28, the very last breath of verse, Matthew chapter 8, the very last breath of verse 24, it says this, "But he was asleep." Now, if we follow Matthew and we take Matthew's account of this miracle chronologically, we think about this, all right? I want to set the tone for you. Matthew chapter 5, 6, and 7. It's Jesus' Sermon on the Mount. And that's enough right there to make anyone, that's more preaching and teaching than I've ever done and will ever do in all my life. Everything that he said there was a mouthful. Okay? And then, after he did that, there was a leper in his path and he cleansed him. He made him whole. And then there was a centurion servant who needed to be healed. And remember, Jesus said, "I'll come and heal him." He said, "No, if you just say that this right here will be done, it'll be done." And then Peter's mother-in-law was sick. She had a fever. And so he healed her of her fever. And in the midst of trying to do that, they brought all these demon-possessed people in verse 16 of Matthew chapter 8. And he cast out the spirits with a word and healed those who were sick. And then everyone gathers around him and there's all these great multitudes and he tells them about how it's going to cost you a lot to follow him. And then he said this right here. He said, I need to get away from all these people. And he goes and gets in this boat and he goes to sleep. On Sunday afternoon, I is tired. Okay? And I didn't hardly do 10% of what he just had to do and what he went through. No wonder he got in that boat and fell asleep. You know, it's one of the things where as long as I keep moving, I won't fall asleep. But if I ever get still, I'm going to fall asleep. And I'm going to sleep good. No wonder Jesus was tired. And he got in that boat. And in Mark, it says he got down. And depending on your version, it says he goes to the back of the boat and he falls asleep on a cushion or a pillow. I don't know what he had. I just know this. He was so tired that when the storm happened and everybody was screaming thinking they were about to die, he was still asleep. And he wasn't worried about it. Jesus being silent is something and seen and perceived by those around him as something that is odd and different. It's nothing new. It happens a few times in Jesus' life. In Matthew chapter 27 and verse 11, when Jesus is on trial, says this, Jesus stood before the governor, and the governor asked, "Are you the king of the Jews?" And Jesus said, "You have said so." But when he was accused by the chief priests and elders, he gave no answer. What's the translation? He was silent. And then verse 13 says, Pilate said to him, "Do you hear how many things they testify against you?" But he gave him no answer, not even to a single charge. So that the governor was greatly amazed. And over in Isaiah 53, verse 7, he says, "It was like a lamb before his shears are silent, so he opened not his mouth." And Jesus was silent. And Pilate was so confused by his silence. He was expecting a defense. He was expecting a defense. Here is this great orator, this teacher, this rabbi that had been followed around by all of these multitudes performing all of these wonderful miracles. And here they are testifying against him. He was wanting something out of him. You know, I don't know if he was waiting on him to do a Ben Matlock or what he was, but he expected a strong defense, a weak defense, a mediocre defense. He was expecting him to say something, speak. Say something. Do you not hear what these people testify against you? And he gave no answer. Here he is on this boat. He's in the back of the boat. He's asleep. He's not saying a word. And everyone comes to him and they're all afraid that they're going to die. And there he is. He's not saying a word. If Jesus is silent, there's no need for us to panic. We don't need to fill our lives up with worry and fear and panic about all of these things that Jesus said. Don't worry about these things. But so many times, that's exactly what we fill our lives up with. So we have here Jesus being silent. When it seems like he has deserted you, when you feel abandoned, when you feel all alone, don't worry, he's right beside you. He's in the boat with you. He's in the boat with you. Why is he in the boat with you? Because you followed him on the boat. And why in the world would he take you through a storm if you followed him and you went through that storm? Why would he take you through that storm for something bad to happen? Well, he didn't do that. Being right beside you, we may need to be reminded that when he is right beside you and you followed him on that boat, that it is okay. And as a matter of fact, it's all right and it is encouraged to do so for you to cry out for help. I had somebody very wisely say this morning in Bible class, some of y'all need to hit up Jesus with a prayer. Matthew chapter 8 and verse 25, they say this. When they went and woke him saying, "Save us, Lord, we are perishing." You know, were they overcome with fear? Were they afraid? Absolutely. Well, they were about to die. And when you are overtaken with fear, and when you are scared and afraid, many times we begin to shake and we become like a stone. I mean, when you are truly afraid, it's hard to do anything. You're locked up. And so many times we lose fact, and I will too, I will lose sight of the only thing that can help me. I will panic, I will be afraid, and I'll lose my focus. I look at everything going on around me and all of the things that are falling apart, and then it just seems like there's more falling apart around me because I'm looking in more places, and I forget who I'm with. The disciples remembered. What did they do? They asked Jesus to help them. That's what they did. Is our reaction in times of trouble to throw up a panic prayer? That's what they did. They threw up a panic prayer. They were scared. They didn't know what to do. And they cried out to Jesus, "Lord, save us. We are perishing." Or is our reaction, "I'm perishing. I'm dying up. What can I do to fix this and make this better? Maybe I can't fix it. Maybe I need to make it easier. Maybe I can't make it easier. Maybe I need to make it easier for everybody around me. Maybe if I can't make it easier for everybody around me, and I can be a stone wall and I can be something that everybody can look to, when we need to be asking Jesus for help. And we need to be asking everyone around us to cry out to God on our behalf, Lord, save us, we are perishing." Worry is a useless folly. But prayer in times of distress will always get us what we need, even though it may not be what we want. But I feel like I got more control when I worry than when I give it up to God. This one time I was going down a river, we were kayaking, and I got capsized. That's a fancy word for I got thrown out of that boat. And as I got thrown out of this boat and I held onto this boat, I had zero control of the boat. I had zero control of myself. I had zero control of anything except for trying to hold my head above water. And that's why I had a hold of the boat. Did I know where the boat was going? No idea. Was it going somewhere good? Probably not, or I would have still been in the boat. And all of a sudden, you hear these things when you're in a place like this. There's several people that stand on the side, and they have a bunch of ropes. And then you hear this, you hear the most beautiful words in all the world, "Rope!" And then they begin to throw. And if this ever happens to you, you got a decision to make. Okay? You kind of got three options. Two really good options. One, if you're really feeling dicey, option. Number one, you can hold on to the boat. Zero control. You're just going to go where the current takes you. It may be into a tree. It may be into a bunch of rocks. It may be into a tree sticking out over the water with an undercurrent, and you're going to get swept up underneath that tree. You can hold on to the boat. That's option one. Option two, you can let go of said boat and grab onto the thing that's going to save you, which is the rope. It's a good odds that if somebody who has tried this many times, that rope probably hits you in the face, literally, when they threw it. If not, it's probably within arm's reach. And you just grab a hold of that rope, and you can hold onto that rope, and they're on dry land, and they are going to pull you to safety. Option three, if you're feeling kind of dicey, is you can grab a hold of said rope and you can continue to hold onto the boat. At which point, you will test your chest strength and the patience of everyone on the bank, because now they're having to pull you and the boat to safety. You know what we try to do? I'll get back in the boat. I got it. I got this figured out. Y'all go on about somebody else that really needs help. Y'all find somebody that really needs it. Prayer is our lifeline. Prayer is our rope. And if we will not cry out for help, He is the only source of peace that we're going to find. So many times we like to remain with this figment of our imagination that I got it and I got it under control. When you don't have anything under control. In our panic, He is our calm. He is our steady eddy that will help us. Last thing we need to do is we need to learn to look back. I don't mean looking back like Lot's wife. She was told, don't look back, y'all get out of here. But we need to look back upon past success. And knowing Jesus' impact upon our lives during a present storm will help us when we face the next storm. In Matthew chapter 8 and verse 27, it says this, that the men marveled. The men marveled. They saw this. They were astonished at what they had just seen. Jesus asleep in the back of the boat. They go wake him up and everything is calm. Peace be still. Everything's finished. It's the true ultimate calm after the storm. And everyone was perplexed by this. And Mark, it says this, it was at this point, the word fear isn't really used until he finishes everything. You know, they go to him in panic and in fear and in worry, but it doesn't say that they were fearful. It says that at the end of the account in Mark 4, verse 41, they feared exceedingly. Who is this that has the power that the storms and the seas obey him, that the wind and the sea obey him? That's what scared them. Who is this guy that we got with us? They just thought they were afraid before. Now they're really afraid. This was a life-changing moment for these disciples. This changed everything. How often did they recount this story to themselves, amongst themselves, and to others when they would get to the other side? I mean, you won't believe what happened. You will never believe what happened. Jesus of Nazareth, he was asleep in the back of the boat. We thought he was, you know, he had the rudder back there, sheep. He was in the back of the boat. He was asleep, though. And then a storm came up, and we tried everything. We had buckets, and we had cups. Everybody, we were throwing stuff overboard. We were trying to maintain control, and we went back there to Jesus and said, do you not care that we're about to die? And he got up and said, oh, me, again. And he walked up to the front of the boat, and he said, peace be still. And everything stopped. I mean, you got to go find out more about this guy. How many times do they tell that story? I can tell you right now, I would be telling that story all the time. Because that was a life-changing moment. You see, I believe that this event, and looking back on this event, while maybe not the greatest, you know, story they ever told, but it would give them confidence to face the next storm. This is a growing thing. Does that mean that they had success in the next storm? Well, I don't know if they were totally successful. But I do find out about one storm a little while later when they were in the boat again. Over in Matthew chapter 14. In Matthew chapter 14, and beginning in verse 22, we have the account of where Jesus walks on the water. And remember that they were out in the middle of the sea, and the waves were tossing them about, and the wind was contrary. It was about fourth watch of the night, and Jesus went to them walking on the sea. Disciples thought they saw a ghost. They cried out in fear, and he says, be of good cheer. It is I. Do not be afraid. And Peter said this, if it's you, let me come to you. You know, the way that they have grown, and the way that they are growing, Peter went from being on that boat with the disciples, you know, and thinking, man, here we are, we're about to die, and they got Jesus in the boat, that now he ain't even worried about walking out on the water to Jesus in the middle of a storm. He said, I know I've got Jesus with me, it won't matter. And as long as Peter stayed fixated on the end goal and his eyes on following Jesus, nothing bad happened to him. But every storm, we should grow. We should not have little faith. We should have big faith. Storms come, we grow, we repeat. We may not like the results of a certain storm, but it's not as bad as it was the first time, and we keep following Jesus. The tempest is raging, and our lives are being tossed about to and fro, and we don't know where to go, and some of us set sail without a Savior, and those are doomed for destruction. Without Him, you are perishing. There is zero chance of survival on that boat. You will surely die. But when you have Jesus on the boat, when we leave port and we're following the Savior, we have comfort in knowing that even if the storm takes this present body, our eternal life rests secure as our faith in Jesus is secure. If you are here this morning and you are setting sail in your life without Jesus in the boat, you are perishing and you are doomed to die. You will have zero chance. And let us, when we follow after the Savior, when we know that we are in the middle of a storm, let us always look to Him. Let that become the essence of our being, that we're following after Him. We trust Him. We will be encouraged by Him and how we live our lives. If you're subject to the Lord's invitation, please come as we stand and as we sing.
Thank you.